Okay, welcome to church, everybody here in the pews and those who are watching online or on YouTube. A very great welcome for the last Sunday before we hit winter. So it is just, for many reasons, a time to celebrate. So let's begin with the reason we've come here today. So let's stand and sing, "We've Come Into His House." Of some of the things that we need to be aware of that are happening around us. And Sue's going to bring them to us.
There are quite a few dates that we'd really like to put before you. They have passed church council, so they're absolutely going ahead. First one's today, actually, because on the fifth Sunday of the month, which we have, I think, four times a year, we don't have a hospitality team assigned to that. So if you're available, please ring up, say, me or somebody that you think might know what's happening. And we do need your help to clean on the Saturday and prepare on the Saturday and to bring some stuff for morning tea. So that's on the fifth Sunday, which is today. The next thing would be TWEET, which is those who eat alone talk to themselves. That's what that means. And it happens on the first Sunday. They go out for dinner, lunch, on the first Sunday of the month, which is next Sunday. All right? Huh? Here. You go out to lunch. Have it here. Next one is our pudding competition. So it's a meal, a three-course meal for $20, and a Christmas pudding competition. So if you have a bit of an ego about how good your Christmas pudding is, make one and enter it, and there's a competition. That's on the 2nd of July. Next one is the parish dinner on the 27th of August. Okay. There's also a walk for refugees on the 19th of June. But also there's a notice in there, if you are able to help mowing, just lately the mowing has been very constant for everybody, can you contact Peter on that number, please? He mostly mows on a Friday. Sometimes he fits it in Friday morning. So if you could help then, that would be wonderful. Thank you. Read all of these carefully. There's a lot of information in there. Thank you.
Now, the theme of the service today is we are many, but we are one. And so we'll listen to Jesus' prayer for his disciples to be united, one in God, one in Christ, one in the Holy Spirit. For this is how the whole world will know him. We are many, but we are one in Christ Jesus. So as we come before God, we are called into worship. The world belongs to God. How good and lovely it is. Love and faith come together. Lord, open our lips. Let us be still and remember we are in the presence of God, our Father, Jesus, our Saviour, and the Holy Spirit, our guide and our sustainer. So let's pray. Almighty and awesome God, in you is all glory and truth. In you is the light of our world. Jesus the Christ, in you is the church enlivened and brought into community through the Holy Spirit. In you is life abundant and eternal. In you is the beginning and the end. For all of this, and for so much more, we give to you our heartfelt thanks. Loving and gracious God, you call us to this place and in this time, so that we might worship you, so we might feel your presence here among us, that we might be encouraged by your spirit of community right here, here in this place. So bless this time of worship. May it enliven and encourage us, that we might go from here refreshed by your living water. Amen. So let's stand and sing in praise to God. Come sing praises to the Lord above.
Come sing praises to the Lord above. Rock of our salvation, God of love. With delight into God's presence move. For the Lord our God is King. God is King above the mountains high, the oceans deep, the land and sky. Mighty continents and islands lie within the hollow of that sand. Come to worship in a bowed knee, praise a shepherd with humility. Humble creatures in his hands are we, sing the praise of God the King. God is King above the mountains high, the ocean deep, the land and sky. Mighty continents and islands lie within the hollow of that sand. Hear the story of God's people now. You can stop and hearts and bloom and bow. Learn what happened long ago and God. God can show you who is King. God is King above the mountains high. The ocean is deep, the land is sky. Mighty continents and islands lie within the hollow of the sand. 40 years I kept the prize away, made them wander till they pulled away. Exiled all of them until the day they belong in God's King. God is King above the mountains high, the ocean deep, the land of sky. Mighty continents and islands lie within the hollow of the sand.
Please be seated and Lynn will bring us our readings for today.
We're reading from the Gospel of John, chapter 17, verses 20 to 26. I ask not only on behalf of these, but also on behalf of those who will believe in me through their word, that they may all be one. As you, Father, are in me and I am in you, you may they also be in us, that they may believe that you have sent me. The glory that you have given me, I have given them, so that they may be one as we are one. I in them and you in me, that they may become completely one, so that the world may know that you have sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me. Father, I desire that those also whom you have given me may be with me where I am to see my glory, which you have given me because you loved me before the foundation of the world. Righteous Father, the world does not know you, but I know you, and these know you that you have sent me. I made your name known to them, and I will make it known, so that the love with which you have loved me may be in them and I in them. And the Revelation reading comes from chapter 22, verses 12 to 14, then 16, 17 and 20. See, I'm coming soon. My reward is with me to repay according to everyone's work. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. Blessed are those who wash their robes so that they will have the right to the tree of life. And it is I, Jesus, who sent my angel to you with this testimony for the churches. I am the root and the descendant of David, the bright morning star. The Spirit and the bride say, come. And let everyone who hears say, come. And let everyone who is thirsty come. Let anyone who wishes to take the water of life as a gift. The one who testifies to these things says, surely I am coming soon. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. The grace of the Lord Jesus be with all the saints. Amen. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
What have I got? I've got some sticks. How many people watched Britain's Got Talent on TV the other night? Nobody. Well, there was a very strong man there who could break everything. He actually put things behind his back and he broke it on his back. He was very strong. But I think these sticks can also be very strong. I wonder if we could break it, whether I could actually break it, and I'm not that good, so I can't break it. Would you like to have a go? Okay, so we can't break it. I want us to think about it as being a parable. I want us to think this could be our congregation. Our congregation in all its sizes and the way in which we do things. We've got thin ones, we've got fat ones, we've got big ones, we've got little ones. So, it can be our congregation, but it can also be the church in the world. And again, we have small churches, we have big churches, we have churches that are really small in number. We've got churches that are big in number. While they're like that, we can't really break them apart. They are all one. They are held together by the three in one, by God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. All together as one. But what about if we take that away? First of all, let's say one of them goes their own way. We lose someone from the congregation. We lose a church here and there. And they say, I can actually worship God on my own. I can worship God without the rest of the churches. What happens? they easily break. So there is strength in being together. There is strength in the fact that we worship together, and we are worshipping as we worship together with the presence of God. So it really is a parable about the strength of our congregation and the strength of the Christian church. United, we can be so strong. Divided, we become so much more vulnerable. We really do need each other. We need people to stand with us as we proclaim the gospel. So let's stand and sing from Building a People of Power. Build your church, Lord. And we now come before God with our prayer of confession. So let's pray. Lord Jesus Christ, we are your church, your body in our world. We did not choose it. You gave it to us. And we marvel at our great privilege to be a part of it. But we do regret our failures in building it into the church that you meant it to be. Forgive us for those times we have honoured our branch of the church above the church universal. When we've been jealous of denominations that seem stronger than ours. When we've been critical of those that we have deemed weaker. Forgive us when we've denigrated other churches and treasured the things that divide us more than the precious pearl that we hold in common trust. Lord, in our own congregation here today, forgive our shallowness in our loving, for our silences when we should have spoken up, for our quickness in talking when we should have listened. Forgive us when we've rejoiced with some members and ignored the plight of others. Lord Jesus, we are your body. We are frustrated and fallible. We are flawed and fragile. We are tired and weak. But through you, we can be made new as we continue our prayer, as we stay seated and sing, Change My Heart, O God.
Change my heart, O change my heart, oh God, make
Jesus says, I love you, I want you, and I am with you always. Your sins are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Now, today's gospel passage seems at times a little difficult to follow. And it seems to be a little hard to know what Jesus is really saying. But let's remember when it was that he actually spoke these words. It was a prayer that ended the time those disciples had spent together celebrating the Passover meal. And it is straight after this prayer they leave to go to the Garden of Gethsemane so that Jesus can pray alone, so that he can wrestle with the horrible knowledge of what was right about to happen. And so he prays with those disciples before they leave. And these words became his last teaching, albeit in the form of a prayer. And it's a prayer for them, but it's also a prayer for us. And I had a bit of an epiphany and realised that what Jesus was doing then is something akin to what we do in our corporate prayers during our worship. He said that they may be one as we are one, I living in them, you living in me, that their unity may be complete. So shall the world know that you sent me and that you love them as you love me. Now note that little word, so. It highlights how the world knows God is present, that his love is seen where people touch each other's lives, spending quality time together, listening with Christ's grace, being one, united in his kingdom. In other words, the revelation of God's love is found in relationships. Relationships with God and with each other. Long before Dorothy Day became a Catholic, she had a sense of the gospel as she worked among the poor and the victims of injustice. The church began to attract her through her experience of living in community with some roommates who believed devoutly in God and were followers of Jesus Christ. But she became a Catholic because of her need for connection, to be an integral part of a faith community. And so the institutional church became for her something she both criticised and loved. For being part of it brought her immense comfort, strength, joy. Whatever its deficiencies, her church was a community that she cherished, rich in relationships with others and with her God. So Jesus prayed that there would be a unity among his believers, united in him as a powerful witness to the reality that is God's love for all of us, whatever denomination, whatever group to which we belong. So what about all those denominations? What about our differences in doctrine? What about our preferences for our own brand of worship? What about our different treasured histories? The way we view the sacraments, and so on and on and on. So what about them? Whatever they may be, we are bound together with others as the church, the body of Christ. United with Christ means we are obviously united with each other. We share a common faith in the triune God. Created, saved from the consequences of our sin, guided along our faith journey by the Holy Spirit. We share a common goal, to follow Jesus wherever it is that he may lead us. But then unity doesn't mean sameness. Look around us, not one of us looks the same. We complement each other in our reaching out into the world with our message of the kingdom of God. So it's unity in diversity of race, of colour, of culture. We don't have to frame our worship to be the same. We don't have to build our churches to look the same. We don't have to offer the same ministries out into the world. But we do have to display the love of Christ. Although we are many, we are still one in Christ. And so together, in spite of our differences, in Christ's hands, we can accomplish miracles. And that's happening right now, here, there, and all around the world. Now, Act for Peace is the international humanitarian agency of the National Council of Churches here in Australia, of which Uniting Church is a very significant member. And at the present moment, they're working with their partner agency, the Hungarian Interchurch Aid, in order to distribute food, water, blankets, and necessities to thousands of families who fled Ukraine into Hungary. Jan Cousins, the CEO of Act for Peace, wrote, "The last few months have been some of the most challenging in my time with Act for Peace. I am overwhelmed by the sheer scale of suffering we've witnessed since both the fall of Afghanistan and the war in Ukraine. In the face of such despair, I take heart in the incredible outpouring of love and kindness that we're seeing towards the refugees and displaced people. I've been moved to tears by the images of volunteers dropping off water and nappies to Ukrainian women and to children who fled their homes. In Poland, parents left prams at the railway station. In Germany, crowds waited at the train station with homemade signs welcoming those exhausted refugees, offering them a place to stay, whether it's overnight or semi-permanent. More than 11 million people have had to flee their homes, creating a humanitarian crisis not seen in Europe since World War II. And that's only Ukraine. These aid agencies, they're made up of many denominations, and they're working in many places all around the world. And they're all distributing love and practical aid in the name of Christ. And they work together. They work with each other to bring hope out of despair. We are many, but we are one in the love of Christ Jesus. And in our relationships between denominations, I believe we are fast breaching the wall of suspicion and distrust that have plagued the church throughout history. Here in our town, we feel comfortable in each other's meeting places. we become very aware that what we have in common far outweighs our differences. That we are just separate members of the same one body of Christ. That we are branches that come forth and are sustained by the vine that is Christ. And that we're reaching out beyond walls to display a unity of faith and purpose. And that brings us back from the world to the town, to us here in this place. And each one of us is different in our needs and our abilities, in our hopes and our desires, even in the depth of our faith, in the way we like to worship, in what it is that we can offer Christ. But it all works when we come back to relationships, to the love of Christ within us, to recognising the love of God in others. So our differences don't matter if we have that unity of purpose, to spread God's hope and love to each and everyone we meet. That is what makes us one. A woman's happiness was shattered by the loss of her dearly loved brother. Torn by anguish, she kept asking God why. Hearing only silence, she set out in search of an answer. Not far along, she came upon an old man sitting weeping. "I've suffered a great loss. I'm a painter and I've lost my sight." The woman invited him to join her in their search for the answers to the why. And soon they overtook a young man pacing around aimlessly. He'd lost his beloved wife to another man. And so he too joined the quest for answers. Then they met a young woman weeping on her front doorstep, for she'd lost her child. And she too joined the search. And it's right then that they came upon Jesus. And each one confronted him with their questions. Jesus gave no answer. Instead, he started to weep. And he said, "I am bearing the burden of a woman who's lost her brother. A girl whose baby has died. A painter who's lost his sight. And a young man who's lost a love." And as he spoke, the four moved closer and closer until they were embracing each other. And they grasped Jesus' hands. And he spoke, saying, "My dominion is the dominion of the heart. I cannot prevent pain. I can only heal it." "How?" asked the woman. "By sharing it," he said. And then he was gone. And those four, they were left holding on to each other. Unity in need. One in diversity. One in love. One in relationship. One in Christ Jesus. And that is all that matters. Amen. Let's stand and sing a hymn that brings that together. Father, Lord of all creation.
Father, Lord, all creation, from the open, I find love, I tend to be on.
Before we have the offering, I found this yesterday, which was too late to get it up on the screen for you. And it was this. It was a declaration that was signed by 15 members of the National Churches in Australia in 2004. Now, that's 18 years ago. And this was what they affirmed, this is what they declared, and this is what they signed. We affirm our commitment to one another as partners in the ecumenical journey. We believe we are being blessed in our generation to witness the action of the Spirit in drawing the churches into a common search for a fuller expression of unity. We rejoice in all we have in common, and we give thanks for the richness of diversity, while recognising that our disunity is a hindrance to the church's mission. We recognise one another as communities of faith, hope and love, committed to following Christ and pledged to serve God's kingdom. We therefore make a commitment to each other to engage in an ongoing process of growing together, not knowing what visible form unity, which is God's will and gift, may take, but believing we shall be led to grow even more deeply into that unity. And that was 18 years ago, and I think we have taken great steps since then. Never will we be ever getting rid of all our denominations, because like people, we are all different and we want to show our love to Christ differently. But that is what was pledged 18 years ago. And as we now come to that time when we offer God our money, but more than our money, we offer him that commitment that we will strive in love to be one together. So your offerings will now be received. Stay seated for the doxology because it is a meditative one. For linking our lives with yours through Jesus Christ our Lord. We offer these gifts as signs of our gratitude and our commitment to make your name known and the love of Christ visible through our worship, our witness, and our service. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
for our prayers for others. We come to you in our prayers for people we know that and those that are far from us. Dear Lord, help us to always be aware of those who are close to us who are struggling. Help us to see where we might be able to help ease their situation, or just to support and comfort them as they travel the difficult path ahead for them. Remind us that, like Job's friends, our advice and platitudes are of little help, but our prayers and genuine offers of assistance, no matter how small, might just be what's needed. Dear Lord, we pray for those we know whose physical and mental health is frail. Again, show us how we can best be a friend in their time of need. In a time of loneliness and sorrow, we pray that we can offer the hand of friendship that buoys the lonely soul. We pray for the people who have suffered loss and anxiety through the recent floods. Help them to find solutions that will put their mind at rest through the agencies that are offering assistance. We pray for those whose work is a burden, and for those who carry the burden of not enough or unsatisfactory work. Show them opportunities to explore the right balance for their labours. Dear Lord, we pray for our new government, that they may always honour the role they have been elected to work with integrity for our country, to maintain prosperity for all and national security. And to the people far from us, dear Lord, at present we think of the people in Pacific Islands whose homes are threatened by rising oceans. Their problem is constant and becoming more urgent, and is something all nations have contributed to and are responsible to halt and heal. Help us to willingly carry this responsibility. Our homes may never be flooded, but others are, and to accept the costs involved in managing this growing concern. And the people of Ukraine are still fighting for their survival. Dear Lord, is this really part of your plan? We pray that they will be delivered from this uncalled for aggression, so they may continue to live in their own country in the safety we take for granted. And as Jean has said, Jesus can heal pain, so we bring their pain to you. But we see the love poured out to those who are helping, and that would be part of the plan too. We pray for those persecuted for their race, gender preference, age, appearance. Help us to see the individual, not the differences to our norm. We pray for the young families who come to Mani Music, that they might open their minds and hearts to you and so begin to lead their families in your ways. We pray for the families of those affected by the shooting in Texas, the families of those who were killed, and those who will live in trauma from the experience. We really can't imagine why no effort has been made to address the gun laws that enable such events to occur time and time again. Dear Lord, we bring these concerns to you and join in the prayer you taught your people. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
And we sing a hymn that actually was one of Gordon's favourites, but it brings everything in together. Christ be our light.
Longing for light, we wait in darkness. Longing for truth, we turn to you. Give us your own, your holy people, light for the world to see. Our strength be
As servants of Jesus Christ to make a difference in our world. Go out to proclaim that all who are thirsty can drink from the water of life. Come, Lord Jesus. May the grace of the Lord Jesus be with God's holy people. Amen.
And now you
probably noticed we haven't actually had a
passing
the peace. So you're going to do it as we sing our final song. So it's not a hard one. We're going to sing it through twice, and you should be able to do it nearly without having to look at the words, because it's "We are one in the bond of love."
So say it to each other.